my gosh, that was amazing. I'm out of breath, but I'm not sweating as much as Congressman Jeffries, I don't think.
No.
Okay. I'm like, wow, I am out of shape. Okay. How's it going? Awesome. Well, it is so great to be here in Chicago with you. And I saw that Blues Brothers video this morning, and I was in the green room by myself doing the twist, doing the shout. So I'm feeling energized. And following Congressman Jeffries, obviously, it's a high bar, so no pressure. But before I get started, I just wanted to recognize the incredible leaders up on this stage and your president, Fred Rolando, who... Fred is the embodiment of the qualities that we look for in a leader. He is smart, he is dedicated, he is hardworking. No one will outwork Fred. But what I love even more is that he's understated. He is not driven by ego. He is always bringing a practical idea or solution to the table. He's got an incredible sense of humor, which we so need in this labor movement. And he and I were actually the dynamic duo when I was Secretary Treasurer. He was the vice chair of our finance committee. And we went through a lot of battles together. And so I'm just so grateful to Fred for his partnership in so many ways in all things. So thank you, Fred. And of course, to Executive Vice President Brian Renfro, I just, you bring such an incredible energy and your experience to the table, so refreshing. I have to give a word to Secretary Treasurer Nicole Ryan, just because I was a fellow Secretary Treasurer, and I know that job. It is sometimes very thankless, but so important. So thank you. And to the members of the Executive Council, thank you, thank you, thank you for leading this union through some incredibly challenging times. And you think about those challenging times. You have faced new management at the Postal Service. You have faced a pandemic that led more people to staying home, but then that translated into more delivery orders. You've taken on a growing role in our democracy and in our elections. And despite all of those new hurdles, you've continued to serve the public every step of the way. You are such an integral part of your communities, delivering everything from letters to paychecks to ballots, making sure people get their prescription medications, checking in on your neighbors, and you have your finger on the pulse in a way that no one else does. And we see how you step up over and over again to fight to elect the leaders that your communities need and the leaders that working people need. Not just through making sure that every ballot gets delivered, but by helping to build support for pro-worker candidates. And you have lived firsthand with the effects of politics. And you know the difference it makes to have champions who fight for us in the halls of power. And so here's what that looks like. It looks like getting the Postal Service Reform Act enacted, finally. Oh yeah. Finally eliminating the pre-funding mandate and permanently protecting six-day mail and package delivery. That's right. And it looks like having leaders who keep working people front and center in our plans for recovery, from the American Rescue Plan all the way to the infrastructure bill. It looks like delivering a huge win on the Inflation Reduction Act that the Senate just passed last weekend. That's right, huge, huge victory. Not many people know that the Inflation Reduction Act is going to deliver, I want to use that word deliver as much as I can today, huge benefits to strengthen the middle class, protect our environment, cut the cost of prescription drugs, that's right, and our healthcare premiums. So it's a huge win for seniors, for working people, and for future generations, which it's hard sometimes to think about when we're faced with so much day to day that's right in front of us. But this is an investment in the long term. And I think we need to do a better job as a labor movement explaining what these bills have in them and how they're going to impact people's lives. So this Inflation Reduction Act also includes more than $3 billion for the USPS to purchase zero emission vehicles so that you can help drive us into a clean energy future. So because we, as a labor movement, actually fought for this bill to include labor protections and domestic content requirements, it's going to create millions of good-paying, family-supporting union jobs for generations. That is what's possible when we fight to elect leaders who will fight for us. And we need to bring that same fight to this upcoming election, so we can build on that majority. And we have, what, 89 days left to do it. That scares me a little bit. We're under 100 days, folks. And so when we leave this convention, we have to make the most of every single one of those 89 days, right? In our communities. And that's why today is so important. It's Political Fun Day, and I see a lot of gray t-shirts out in the audience. You recognize the importance of engaging. And when you look across the country right now, and even in your own communities, you see how polarized we are, don't you? Do you feel it? You know, a lot of people are in their corners politically, and it's very divided right now. And this idea of getting out and talking about politics can actually seem kind of daunting right now. I know some people are afraid to talk to their members. But listen, we are the only people who actually can get out there and break through the noise. The echo chambers, I call it the Facebook bubble, right? People are getting their news from Facebook. Cable news bubbles that, you know, people are in these rabbit holes and they just basically only get one source of information. And that is what is leaving us more divided than ever. And in fact, you may have heard, there was a Gallup poll recently, and it was measuring the public institutions in our country, like Congress and libraries and churches, and all of the public institutions in the country are declining in trust. There was one that was not declining. Any guesses? Unions. People trust unions. That's right. And so we need to make the most of that trust. With all the misinformation out there and all the disinformation, we have a responsibility to lead in this election and every election going forward. In fact, I think we are the only ones that can reach real working people and have those one-on-one, face-to-face conversations, because that is the only way you break through the noise. Is people talking to each other, and nobody talks to each other anymore. And you think about all the ways we can reach our members, and you're doing it, right? We're calling them, we're knocking on their doors, we're talking to them. When we talk to our members face to face, we have data that shows they are 7 times more likely to listen to the message because it's coming from someone they trust. And they're having a dialogue, and they're listening and talking with each other, right? So I say that because that is the most important thing we can do when we leave this convention, is talk to our members about what's at stake. And we at the AFL-CIO want to help you and support you in doing that when you get back to your communities and have those conversations. And so we have this network, and Fred knows it, you all, many of you are engaged in it. We have this network at the AFL-CIO. Every state has an AFL-CIO. Every local community and city has a local labor council that brings all of our unions together. Raise your hand if you're involved in your central labor council or your state federation. All right, we see a lot of hands up. We need more. That's right. And that infrastructure gives us a unique reach. The labor movement is everywhere. No one else has that. So we're going to talk to our members. We're going to listen to them about the issues that they care about. And then we connect that to the candidates who share our values. And so if you haven't already, I never leave a crowd without an ask, right? If you haven't already, connect to the AFL-CIO in your local area, your labor council. That's step one. And then step two is appoint someone in your branch or your local or your area that has, it's either a volunteer or someone that wakes up every single day thinking about ways to mobilize your membership. Can you do that? Can you do that? That's what I thought. Because when we build those connections and use our organizing capabilities for politics, we build power. Power for working people. And I know there's a lot of skepticism out there, okay? People are like, oh, we can never reach, break through and reach our members. We can, you know, can we do that? Can we preserve our pro-worker majority in Congress? There's a lot of people talking about that already, right? Can we pass the Workers' Rights Amendment here in Illinois? I thought the Chicago folks would say yes. So there's a lot of skepticism out there, right? And what I want to say is don't buy into that narrative. Because if we do buy into that negative narrative, it'll guarantee that it will happen, right? So let's do what unions do best. Join together and fight back and fight for a better future for working people. And that's what we're busy thinking about as a federation. I want us to use the power of our 57 unions, 12.5 million working people, to take on the big challenges together. It sounds so simple, right? That notion of solidarity. But using the power to organize and win elections and take on major corporations like Amazon. That's right. And you all know firsthand what working with Amazon is like. USPS delivers more than 1 billion packages for them every single year. And you know that it's letter carriers, it's delivery drivers, it's warehouse workers. There's a whole network of people that are making that happen, who make that company run, who make them successful, who make them record profits. But they don't share that profit with working people, do they? Jeff Bezos, you remember that name? Jeff Bezos earned in 7 seconds what the average Amazon worker earned in a year. 7 seconds. In the time it took me to say that sentence, he earned in a year what the average Amazon worker did. And we know that they're going to do whatever it takes to avoid good pay and benefits and fair treatment of their workers. And we've seen them start to rely more on their own delivery services to try to crush attempts to form unions in warehouses. And you've been focused on Amazon for a long time. And I want our whole movement to join you in fighting back against Amazon. Yes. Just look what we were able to do in Bessemer, Alabama. We came together. We had almost 20 unions joining together with our central labor councils, our state fed. We had more than 100 organizers on the ground in Bessemer, Alabama for that last election. Incredible. And you were there. You had folks there. That kind of collaboration had never been done before. Which to me is so shocking, right? Because we know when unions organize, they often don't want to pull back the curtain and work together. We have to change that. We have to approach organizing like we did in Bessemer, where we're all helping each other. And we came so close in that election, in a right to work state. And I often say that if that election in Bessemer would have taken place in New York, we would have two Amazon unions right now. That's right. And we're going to keep fighting for those workers in Bessemer. But I see that collaboration as a model for organizing across our entire federation. Just think about what we could do if we harnessed all that power and used it to take on companies like Amazon together. You think that would be powerful? That's right. That is the idea behind our new Center for Transformational Organizing. And I call it a startup, right? We're building something to bring the entire movement together to reach our organizing goals. And so the CTO is where we're going to capture the energy of this moment. And you see it all around us, workers rising up, right? Working people organizing in new manufacturing and breweries and coffee shops and stores like REI and Apple. In stadiums and universities and even in the cannabis industry, right? They call it from seed to sale. I'm from Oregon. And in fact, I just met with those workers, and of course they always want to give me something when I leave. But the point is there is no industry that is exempt from union organizing. Even Capitol Hill is organizing right now. So the Center for Transformational Organizing is where we are going to develop movement-wide strategies to organize and build worker power. Yeah. Because we know what we're up against, folks. We know what we're up against. The greed that is taking place in our economy right now is unsustainable. And I know you see it. We do a study every year called Paywatch on our website, AFLCIO.org. You can find it. But we look at the S&P 500, you know, all these big CEOs. And we look at what they get paid. And we measure it against the average worker in their company. And that gap has been growing over time. It used to be like 20 to 1. Then it started ticking up each year. Guess what it is now? 100 to 1? 200? 300? I feel like I'm at an auction. It is 324 times the average worker now, 324 to 1. That is unsustainable. And we know the Jeff Bezoses and the Elon Musks of the world, they have enough money to pay their workers more and treat them better. And we're going to make sure that they do. And I know you're up for that fight, because letter carriers always answer the call when our union brothers and sisters and siblings need you. So how do we rebalance the scales? How do we close that inequality gap? How do we do it? We organize. We organize more people into unions. And there's so much opportunity for organizing out there. Look around us, folks. I mean, the private sector, of course, is only, what, 7% unionized in this moment? Public sector, we have 66% of public sector workers are not yet in unions. And so we're going to need you. We're going to be relying on your expertise to show the rest of the labor movement how to organize, because in an open shop, you have 93% of workers choosing to join your union, which is amazing. We need to show other unions how to do that. And we want to replicate that in all the growing industries of our economy. Because if you look at what industries are growing, think about it. They're mostly non-union. Are we going to let that continue to just happen around us? Is anyone alarmed? Right? So we have big tech, non-union. We have the clean energy economy. Everyone's talking about climate change. We all care about climate change. What we need to care about is having good jobs as we build this clean energy economy. So we need to make them union industries from the start and think about ways that the renewable energy sector is actually intersecting with all of our work so that we all care about that. You know, we talked about this new fleet of zero emission postal service delivery vehicles, right? So that's an opportunity. We have a responsibility to make sure that those jobs that help create those new forms of energy aren't low-wage, non-union jobs. That's right. So we know how to do this. We know how to come together and actually lift standards. And I'm going to tell you a little story about the offshore wind industry. And folks are like, well, why do I care about offshore wind? Well, everyone should care because this is about clean energy and creating a future where our kids can actually breathe clean air and actually thrive, right? So this affects everyone. The AFL-CIO worked with our global union partners in Denmark to actually build a partnership with an offshore wind company called Ørsted. Because in Denmark, like most of Europe, all of the big companies are completely unionized. They do all their work union. Then they come to the United States, not so much. They hire anti-union management. So, what did we do? We built leverage with our labor counterparts in Denmark to work top down with the company Ørsted in their home country. And we were able to negotiate a project labor agreement covering construction of wind farms all up and down the East Coast. So now those construction jobs are going to be good union jobs. That's right. And we want that to be a model for every aspect of the clean energy economy, but every aspect of our economy. And we can use that leverage at the community level, because we want to make sure those clean energy jobs are opportunities available in every community, especially communities of color that have been disproportionately hurt by irresponsible employers who don't care about harming the environment. Because we know there's no racial justice without the economic justice that access to these high road jobs will provide. And we want to take that approach everywhere. And we're not stopping there. Think about technology. And I'm going to talk about technology for a second, and I know everyone's going to like look at their phones or their eyes are going to glaze over, but the technology that is impacting our work is everywhere. Think about your job and how it's changed. Think about how it's reshaping every industry. I truly believe that this is the next frontier of the labor movement. Because it sounds obvious, but if someone wants to develop a technology that's going to improve our workplaces, shouldn't they start by talking to the people who actually will work with it? That's us. It sounds so obvious, but they don't do it. So we need to be at every table creating that next generation of technology so that it works for working people. Because we understand our industries better than anyone. We know what makes sense. We know what's going to be safer. We know what's going to be saving money or not. Talk to us. And they're talking about self-driving vehicles, right? Or robots to deliver mail. Have you heard this? Well, I'm going to go on record today and say that a robot can't check on our seniors. A robot can't have a conversation with someone who may not get many visitors. A robot can't defend our democracy like you did. So So we want to make sure technology makes our jobs better and easier for us, not take them over. And that's why at the AFL-CIO, we're thinking about this. We have a technology institute that we established so that we could bring the brightest minds in research and organizing and innovation together. We want to put workers first and protect the people who make this country what it is. Because we know how to face a tough challenge, don't we? We do it together. We do it together with the strength of all of us across an entire federation of labor. And in this moment where we're facing so many challenges, our jobs, our democracy, our environment, our freedoms, we have to face them together as a movement. There's no other way. So let's keep supporting each other. Let's keep fighting for each other and a better future for the next generation. Because when we face a challenge, we don't give up. We fight back. We fight back when our brothers and sisters and siblings need us. We fight back when our pro-worker majority is on the line. When they say game over, we say game on. So, NALC, let's keep working. Let's keep fighting. Let's keep winning. Because when we organize together, we rise together, and I can't wait to see where we'll go from here. Thank you so much.